if we ask ourselves what constitutes philosophy of education, then you find that in today's contemporary discussions of philosophy of education or philosophy of science or philosophy of language, I mean, you could have philosophy of different subjects, you find that there is an enormous amount of dependence on certain philosophical ideas, theories, vocabularies, concepts, and ways of arguing. You know, that's what it loosely means to say philosophy of something, right? Now, you would find, as I'm sure you're aware, that if you look at these different philosophies, philosophies of science, philosophy of mathematics, philosophy of education, philosophy of art, and so on, that there is a lot of drawing upon of ancient Greek and European sources. So they are very relevant. I mean, I think it's quite impossible to really understand a philosophy of a subject without this historical trajectory, at least in what we loosely call as Western philosophy. So, you know, it's a very interesting question to ask. Why is it that when you go back to the past, or past doesn't have to be ancient, it could be medieval and so on, when you go back and look at what others have thought about certain ideas, why is it that there's such a predominance of very specific cultural communities who are contributing to this? Why is it that the philosophical ideas and concepts from different civilizations like Indian, the Chinese, the African, and the Asian, if you like, in a larger sense, do not appear in this new disciplines called philosophy of education, philosophy of science, and so on? Now, this is not a nationalistic or a civilizational thing. It's just a question of a proliferation of ideas, diversity of different viewpoints. And so, it makes great sense to ask if Aristotle and Plato are useful to understand contemporary education today. What can ancient thinkers in other civilizations who thought extensively about education, where civilizations grew on the idea of teaching and learning, how could they contribute to contemporary discussions in philosophy of education? So therefore, in a sense, you could say that bringing the Indian philosophical systems into dialogue with contemporary philosophy of education is to open the space and enrich the vocabulary of philosophy of education, so that just as fruitful as it has been to use Aristotle, Plato, or Hume and Kant and so on in one tradition, so also you could use other thinkers who have asked very different kinds of questions, who have had very interestingly different ways of doing this. So it's not to say whether they're all doing the same thing. You want to see how different people have done the same thing of education in different ways. Now, if you look at these philosophies of education and science, etc., in the West, there's been a long history of, hundreds and thousands of scholars who have been working on these texts, who have been reinterpreting them, who have been telling us how to read these texts to make sense of contemporary questions. Now, somebody has to do this job for these other philosophies if you want to make them meaningful today. So what is the job of making them meaningful? By drawing on these different traditions and then building upon them to make them relevant today. So why I'm saying that is that gives, if you understand this as the approach, then you can make sense of one trajectory of the set of papers on Indian philosophy. Professor Stephen Phillips, of course, talked about the pramanas, the various ways of knowing, and it tells you a different ways in which we engage with this question of knowing and how these questions are relevant to the context of education and so on. And through that, he also pointed out, perhaps ways in which we could draw upon these Indian philosophical terms for contemporary philosophy of education debates. Then the paper which followed, which was mine, I was actually only concerned with continuing this question of saying, when almost all the Indian philosophical traditions have expended a lot of energy on asking this question, how do you learn from language? I mean, how do you know from language? And I converted it into how do you learn from language, and looked at the, relationship between learning and knowing, and more importantly, how by listening to your word, you come to know what it means. And if more than perhaps any, even compared to so-called Greek and Western philosophy, Indian philosophy's preoccupation with language has been one of the founding pillars of the tradition. So there's an extensively very rich and complex theories of debate, language and debate. So my attempt was just to indicate to people how you could do it, especially to students. To me, the set of people who are going to do this job in the future, create a new way of philosophy of education, has to be young students who are going to look at these as potentially useful research programs. Then the other talks which followed, both Parimal Patil, and then we also had Tiwari and Srivara Varakedi and so on. I think they all went back to this question of making sense of these texts. What does it mean to read an old text? You know, you read this Indian philosophical text. One, there's a question of language. There could be Sanskritic, large most of them in this classical philosophies. They are written in prose forms. They are written like poetry. They are written like verse forms. You know, for example, in my own talk, I was talking about how Indian mathematics is written in a verse form, which looks very different from mathematical text today. So the texts look different. So what does it mean to tell for a contemporary reader, how do you read these texts? Where were these texts to be found? You know, the great tragedy of Indian philosophy is we don't have very good histories of Indian philosophies. We don't have, many of these texts have not been translated yet. We don't have good secondary commentaries on them. So I think what all these speakers did was to focus the question on not just the question of language, but also on the texts. And I think they showed us something about the complexity of Indian philosophy by discussing certain profound differences between different schools. So they actually tell you how people argued, how people thought about things. And I think that connected with certain larger questions in other papers, in the parallel sessions, and also with the first day plenary session by Gopal Guru on who spoke on, education in the context of Ambedkar and Gandhi. And, you know, even Ambedkar and Gandhi, who offer very radically different ways of understanding education, are responding to, if not in some sense drawing from, but also responding to earlier histories of Indian thought. So that is, in one sense, an attempt to bring these points together. On first was on perception, the nature of perception and the senses, because we learn through seeing. And Indian philosophy, all Indian philosophical traditions begin with perception, analysis of perception, telling us how we come to know about the world through seeing, perceiving. And the second major analysis for them is inference, what you might call as thinking, logic, and so on. And the third major one for most of them is language, you know, testimony, learning through language or teaching through language. Because we thought all these are not only central to what are called Indian Pramana theories, theories of knowledge, if you like, but they're also very central to the question of education. I think that, you know, the question of perception and its relation to education is a little more complex, because the philosophical structure of perception is seemingly very different from our day-to-day concerns. But questions of inference and language are extremely important and very central. It's a question of how do I infer? How do I learn from seeing something? How do I know something else? And how do I, what does a teacher teach? If I want a student to learn something, what should I tell the student so that the student learns that, what I want the student to learn? You know, that's actually about the nature of cognition through language, learning through language, knowing through language. And there is, and the good thing about Indian philosophical systems is that almost all of Indian philosophy is built on debates. You know, everybody is fighting against each other. But in doing so, what are they doing? They are refining each other's points. So the refinement of the point is to a very great degree. So it's a great training for students to actually, you know, challenge the presuppositions about how language works, how thinking happens, and read these texts to see what kind of debate people have had about these two things. So I think those two are immediately applicable. There's a lot of interesting work waiting to be done in that.